Hey there, it's just Bobby, and I'm here for you. It's not called Bobby's Here For You, but that would be kind of cool. Make my mom happy. Bobby, wake up, Bobby. That's how she talked. I'm not kidding. It's pretty upsetting. But this is one of those episodes that means a lot to me because I get to call people that leave messages, and they've done it because the number's up at the top of the thing there on your menu and, you know, whatever it's called. And in the header, I don't know what it is, you know, because I'm 104. I'm an oak. I'm an elm. So I think eucalyptus, because I like that in my bathtub. It goes up my my pooter, and it makes me burn. Why? Why say that? Because that's how I'm made. Can't help it. My dad did it to me. Didn't do it to me. My dad never touched me, but I mean he influenced me to do comedy you're not supposed to do. But he also taught me to be a kind person and to care about others. And that means a lot to me that I learned that from him. And then I try to impart it. So this is one of those episodes that I'm excited about because I'm going to call people. You were kind enough to leave your numbers and your messages and what you want to talk about. And I don't even know what the subjects are. I just have your names and your numbers. And what else can I tell you? Will you want to subscribe or follow, whatever you do, where you do your podcast. It's free when you do that, you know. And then review and rate. Always give it a good score. You know, when you say mean stuff, I just get rid of you anyway. No, I don't. I don't. I can take the mean. I don't even look at it sometimes if it's mean. But I try not to block people. But I can't do negative because life's too short. I don't deserve it because I'm a good person. That's what the guy said before he did something wrong. But I am because I don't go nowhere. And I have great grammar. All I do is go to my grammar lessons and they ain't helping me. So I'm going to call somebody right now. This is Evan. Evan, I'm calling Evan. He's going to be my new friend. And I hope he's doing okay. I don't know what area code this is, but it's going to be Evan.
Hello?
Evan, Bob Saget, how are you?
I am great. How are you?
Really good, sir. Really good. So where are you? What part of the world are you?
So I'm actually in Memphis, Tennessee right now, but I was living in L.A. I moved there in January to start my career in the film industry, and then I had to move back here in March when everything shut down.
Yeah, it was weird timing, wasn't it, to start the film industry? Right. So you're a young man, I would say. You finished college. Is that the deal?
I graduated about a year ago.
And what was your studies?
Film.
Oh, right. That's what I did. I went to film school at Temple University in Philadelphia and then moved to L.A. and then ended up not going to grad school at USC and became a comedian at the Comedy Store for free. And it changed my life that I had been a comedian
That's
already.
Awesome.
Well, it was nice of you to call me. Are you hanging in okay? Are you quarantining in Memphis?
I mean, I'm getting depressed a little bit, but I mean, it's just quarantine depression.
Now, the depression, is it anything I need to worry about?
No, it's just from being cooped up.
Right. Are you with people? Are you with anyone?
I am. I'm with my mom right now, who didn't believe you were going to call. Oh, so here, let you say hi to her.
Okay, good. What's her name?
Laura.
Great.
Hey, hello.
Hi, Laura. Bob Saget. How are you?
That's what I heard my son said, so I'm like, yeah, right, whatever. I am well.
No,
well. I think it's my fault. It's my fault that this kid's a fan. Of course, that was way back in the early Full House days, but, you know.
Right, and the video show probably, because boys
oh,
like that.
Oh, my gosh.
Show.
That was awesome, the video show. We still catch those reruns.
That was pre-Wi-Fi. That's how long ago that was. So are you
you're aging me now.
Oh no, you're young forever. So now Evan, is he doing good? Are you taking care of each other? Is it difficult? It's difficult because it is, right?
It's difficult, you know. I mean, Evan had just gone to LA. He's been working as a PA out in LA and had gotten some jobs, and then here came COVID, you know. So
yeah.
As he said this morning, it's not that his dreams are ended, his dreams are just put on hold.
That is the truth with everybody, with most people. You know, it's just the select few get to keep doing stuff because of whatever they do. But when you're starting out, you definitely need to be on the front lines, unless you can do something at your computer screen. But are you doing okay?
I'm okay. I'm you know, I work from home, and so it's fortunate and unfortunate. I work from home even before COVID. I do early intervention. I work with families with children birth to three who are at risk or are born with a diagnosis. So I do a lot of my, and I'm administrator at this point. I'm not too much doing family frontline as much anymore. But it's rough because the families, the population that we serve, are very much struggling through this. Right. I mean, if you're a special needs child and then a special needs child without routine is even harder.
Oh, you're breaking my heart. You're so wonderful to do what you do. Thank you.
Well, thank you. I am going to give you back to Evan because he's got this great big grin on his face and very excited.
Well, I'm going to inspire the lad. And thank you for doing all that you do. Is Memphis hit pretty hard with COVID?
Memphis is hit pretty hard. Our Hispanic and African-American population has been hit the hardest. And part of that has to do with the lack of doctors and for them and lack of really information. Right.
Definitely.
But it's also, that being said, though, Memphis has done a very good job of answering that need and really trying to help the populations as a whole have access to healthcare and to the tests and the information as much as possible.
It's so important. And thank you so much for sharing that with me. And I wish you all the best.
Oh,
and,
well, thank you.
And thanks for all
thank
you do.
And thank you for all the laughs over the years.
I'm going to keep going, even though it's hard sometimes. But that's my job. That's my front line working is to try to get people. Let me talk to Evan and try to get him out of the funk, whatever I can do.
Hey.
Thank you. Boy, you got a great mom there.
Thanks.
A lot of people, she's probably driving you crazy, but that's your problem.
No, we get along pretty well.
Oh, good.
We don't want to trade families yet.
No, good. Yeah, right. So family swap. But some people, they swing with other families. So you graduated, yeah. You were, so what's your question or how can I help you? Would it be advice on how to get through this and get into the business? Is that kind of the area you want to
Advice on because I know you direct too, and I want to write and direct. So right now I'm writing because I need to have something to direct at this point.
The important thing is to write. If you're able to write during this, and depression doesn't help writing. Sometimes you just
especially comedy.
Yeah, and you want to write comedy specifically?
Yeah.
Well, just do it. You know, everybody's saying the same thing. Just do it and then just keep rewriting it. Just keep rewriting it. Write it all. Get something written. I don't know if it's long or short form. I would recommend short form to start. But if you're writing a movie, you're writing a movie. But, you know, there's a lot of demand for stuff. But definitely just keep rewriting it and make it better. And if it sounds like other things you've seen already, try to avoid that and go a different path if it's possible. You know what I mean? So that it's not, it doesn't feel like I was watching something the other night and I'm working on a project and I'm like, oh crap, this is in their project. I can't do that line. I can't do that joke. I can't touch it. So sorry, my voice got high. I'm talking to you. I got youthful. So, so that's kind of all I could say. You're doing the right thing. You have to know there's nothing you can do right now. And if you're able to work and write, you're going to be very appreciative that you took this time to do that because you'll end up with a script or a couple scripts. Go ahead.
I'm trying to write. It's just motivation to do anything is really hard right now.
I know, but kick yourself in the butt. It's best to try it early in the morning. They always say writing is great early in the morning. Some people are late night people, but a lot of times when I write at night, I'm best off just taking my iPhone and putting it in the notes, something I have ideas for, or literally write on my iPhone. And then the next morning I'm able to transcribe it and turn it into something. But
I have to do that. I'll wake up at like 2 a.m. and have an idea and have to write it down on my phone so I don't lose the inspiration or forget it.
Yep. Well, try to get sleep and then try not to spend too much time in the shower because mom knows what's going on. And, you know, what are you going to do? And make sure the locks are good.
Yeah.
Locks are good on the bathroom is very important. deadbolts are good. You know, four deadbolts on the bathroom I needed as a kid. You take care of yourself, okay, ma'am?
Thanks for the inspiration.
Thanks for calling, and be well. And just and when you're back out here, it'll be a different world, and one that you'll, this time you'll go, oh, that's the reason I was doing this for a year and a half. It's about your own self-growth is how what I think. And I don't mean the one that you have to pour cold water on in the shower. I mean, you know, just just make sure that door is locked. Your mom's in the house, for God's sakes. Okay. Take care and tell her thank you.
Thank you, Bob.
Take care, Evan.
Bye.
Bye. My nephew's like that. He doesn't like to say goodbye. I understand. Marissa. I'm calling Marissa.
Hi, this is Marissa.
Hi, Marissa. Bob Saget. How are you?
Fine, Bob Saget. How are you doing?
That's funny. I do have two names. My name is just Bob Saget. I'm good. Where are you, Marissa? What part of the country?
I'm in Berwyn, Illinois, which is about 10 minutes outside of the great city of Chicago.
Oh, yeah. That's where my wife and her family are from. And I know it's been a difficult time with COVID and with everything that's going on with all of the murders, and life is very, very hard. How are you holding up?
Oh, well, thanks for asking. I'm a registered nurse, so I'm actually helping out downtown and in some rural areas with the corona testing. And I feel really fortunate that, knock on wood, my family's been healthy, and I'm glad I get to help other people.
Oh, you're an angel. Thank you. Thank you. Do you get scared when someone tests positive that you could have it after that?
No. What I get scared about is right now our tests are about 2 weeks in turnaround time, and I'm getting people that I know are positive. I mean, I can tell from their symptoms are positive, but...
And those symptoms would be a fever and the lungs, and they have trouble breathing and all that?
A lot of people I'm seeing just come in with no symptoms, except they just say flat out, I can't smell or taste anything. Otherwise, I feel fine.
There it is. Right.
So that seems to, and some people, I've had a couple who have just had some really mild digestive issues. So what's terrifying about it is we don't really know how it presents, but a lot of times if somebody's young and otherwise healthy, I haven't been sick in 3 years and I just don't feel right. There seems to be some correlation there. So, but people in Chicago and Illinois are doing great with the mask wearing. They really are.
Right. Those are good people. They're not, I don't know why people are making this a political thing and about freedoms. It's really about, it's people that don't want to believe in medicine. It just doesn't.
Well, look who's in charge.
Oh, I can't even. I actually have, I bought orange glasses that are tinted, so whenever he's on screen, he disappears. He's invisible because the orange cancels itself out.
What a fantastic idea.
Yeah, it's orange glasses.
Can't even see him anymore.
No, maybe it'll turn out that way.
You still hear him, though. That's the problem. You know, you can still hear him.
Well, if you don't want to, you know, I would rather, you can go online and just listen to scientists, and then you kind of get a better idea, but then you also, I don't know. Some people I know don't watch the news but once a week just to catch up, and then they get real depressed, But my question to you is, like, I'm having a test today in a couple hours because I'm doing some TV show, and they used to stick the whole long swab up the nose, a foot into your brain, and now they're saying they just go like a centimeter into each nostril and twirl around and then put that in the test, and then they do a little prick of the finger, which I had. I was on the Joe Rogan podcast, and I was live there with him, so you have to do that, and I'll be doing it with the TV show. And so what methods are you using right now?
Well, we're doing sort of a two-pronged approach. We are doing antibody testing, which is the blood draw, but we're old school. We have to do actual pricks in the arm or in the wrist or wherever. And we're doing the old school nasal swabs. Like the ones I'm doing, I have to tickle your brain with if I do it right and leave it up there a few seconds if possible.
Do you think that's because they haven't updated the whole country with what VIP people are getting? The easier
absolutely Absolutely.
So the truth is the real machine that needs to be taking place, which is you don't need to shove a swab up into your brain. It can be done with the new techniques, but they're not accessible to everyone, period.
Because those are costing money and everything is rationed right now. And I mean, I'm using 1 gallon a day. I'll test 40 people in a day and I'm using 1 gallon. So wow. I've got one N95.
Oh, that's not good. Have you sneezed in your mask at all? Have you ever done that? Because I have.
Absolutely. It's hard not to.
And then you go, oh no, what am I doing? Am I recycling myself an illness of some kind?
I try to put a surgical mask on and then put my N95 over it. I don't know if that's sanctioned by the CDC, but I feel like if I do sneeze in my mask, I can just switch out one of the cheap ones real quick.
Right. When I sneeze in my mask, I wrap my head in duct tape at that point and just leave it there. And I just cut eye holes.
Over your head.
I've done that. And then I've seen those masks, by the way, online. You see funny stuff. And I actually wear a gown, like an actual gown, like a ball gown. So I wear the same one because I'll never use it again. You know.
Right. Just one time done.
And it was very hard to find it. I had to find it in the store where people were large size.
Tall. You're a tall guy, right?
I'm 6'4", and you know, so I've got to wear those big sizes that are hard to come by for a woman like me. But so did you have a question or something? I love talking to you because you're one of the heroes right now in the world.
Don't call us heroes because that's just an excuse not to pay nurses what they're worth and to skimp on their PPE. We're not heroes.
I think you do.
Our job and be safe.
That doesn't make sense. You're supposed to pay heroes. That's who you pay, right?
Well, I don't know. I mean, Mitch McConnell certainly doesn't think so.
Oh, he was great in Rain Man. He was really he was so good. I would say when you're working with heroes, you add a bunch of zeros. That's my rap.
Oh my God,
for the
that's going to be my campaign slogan in 2024.
When you're working with heroes, add a bunch of zeros.
Working with heroes, add more zeros. I love it.
Yeah.
But then they'll say, okay, so you can add a bunch of losers to your staff. That's not what you meant.
Or the problem is they just add zeros to the left, to the front, and then they don't put a number in front of those. That's not good. So.
Right. So then you're making 0.0.
We can't do that. You got to get the money. Show me the money, baby. You got to get it.
Let me ask you this.
Go ahead.
Mr. Bob, are you a football fan?
I am when I always loved my Eagles in Philadelphia. I mean, I really do love. I've never missed a Super Bowl, but I don't follow it all the time. And right now, it's a little, you know, it's kind of sad right now, but it is what it is. But what was the B-side to that?
Oh, I just am interested in sort of seeing what people think because I'm a huge Packers fan. I've been a Packers fan forever.
Oh my God. I was a Packers fan back when I was a kid, when I was like 16, 17, that was my team. And the Steelers, there were two teams.
And then what happened? Oh, like the Mikowski years and Greg and all that.
Exactly. So what's your football issue right now?
Well, my issue is just that I was really hopeful that there was going to be a season. I mean, that's kind of how I was like boosting myself, you know, through quarantine, you know, let's do the right thing now. But after seeing what's going on with baseball and everything, I mean, I know people don't want to hear it, but I just don't think there's any way to do it and keep the players safe and keep their families safe. I don't think that how can you sustain a competitive advantage because if one person gets it, your position group gets it, period.
That's accurate. And
so if you've got your whole wide receiving core out, what are you doing?
And you can't be running with a mask. You can't run with a mask on. And when you land on someone, a whole bunch of fluids shoot out of your head all over them. There's no way it doesn't.
No,
it's just
no way to keep it safe.
A lot of most sports, it's a snot fest. You know, it just mucus moves, and it's really sad. But it will make it all that more sweet when we're back in a year and people can do it. But
it'll be amazing.
It'll be amazing, and maybe I hate to say this, but And people go, well, I care about right now. And that's understandable because that's what we do care about is right now, today, right this moment. But
right.
we are going to appreciate it more. And if we don't, you know, it's because either tragedy and injustice has struck us, which a lot of people are going through also.
Absolutely.
Or we're just too depressed and we won't get out of the depression. But when this lifts, and it will, and there will be a vaccine, and then eventually everyone will get it, is the hope. But right now, it doesn't look like we're taking care of our people properly. Being that I can go get the little prick on my finger, and I didn't mean that in a dirty way, because I don't want that. And then get the swab, not have a pipe cleaner shoved into your brain, but just do the little teeny thing. That's what we're all, you know, we should deserve.
I'm glad you're doing that. Thank you for doing that.
Oh, I do it all the time because I have to be sure, because I'm not going anywhere. I just don't want to. I take dry cleaning plastic and put it over my head and tie it up. Oh, that no, I'm sorry. That's when that's suicidal. I'm not there. But yeah. Did you have any other questions, or was it really the football issue and how painful that is for you?
The football. Yeah, this was my way of venting in a very public forum, which I didn't necessarily expect, but.
I'm glad you did.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. You're not alone.
To make my day.
You're not alone. Ah,
that's
beyond kind. Thank you, Marissa, and thank you for all you do so much.
Have a great day.
You too. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. I think now's the time to take a little break. We'll be right back. Hey, it's just Bob here from Bob Saget's Here For You, and I want to tell you about Wild Wild Tech. It's a new podcast about the wildest, most bizarre, most interesting stories about technology and how it's shaping our culture. Technology is everywhere, from smartphones to connected cars and complex algorithms. And there's a lot of great stuff. Epidemiologists have studied the video game World of Warcraft and the pandemic that happened in the game so they can better be prepared to fight COVID-19. Or Apple, they wouldn't let bad guys use iPhones in movies, but did you know that Apple changed the way their products look just to make them more appealing in movies? This is the kind of stuff that's on this show. Wild Wild Tech will bring you each topic through the voice of experts who know all about the hidden world of technology and real people who are having their lives changed in strange ways by the digital world. Wild Wild Tech is hosted by Jordan Erica Weber and Joshua Rivera, and they're both incredible writers. And they'll take you into the world and all these crazy stories of things that are technologically based and just obscure stuff you might not know about that's pretty damn important. At the end of the episode, you'll hear a short clip of Wild Wild Tech, and you could subscribe to the show if you like what you hear. Listen and subscribe to Wild Wild Tech on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you're listening now. You can also find a link in the episode notes that will take you right to the show. All right, we're back, and I am calling Casey. Here comes Casey. There's so many good people. There are so many good people doing work. That's who we want to have in our lives. That's who we want to have on the planet. It's people that do things for other people, not just for themselves. It's not bad to do stuff for yourself. I mean, I'm doing this podcast, but it's for me because I get a lot from it, like calling people. But Casey might be a voicemail. I'm gonna leave him a wacky
Hello.
One.
You have reached the cell phone of Casey. Please leave a message after whatever noise this thing makes.
Oh, that's clever. Hey, Casey, Bob Saget here. I'm sorry I missed you. And whatever sound your voicemail makes is just a beep, which is very, very cool. And it's different than everyone else's. Wishing you the best, Casey. Hope you're doing well. I might try you back. I might not. But in any case, wishing you and your family lots of health. And always, I probably shouldn't leave this on your machine. Just wipe front to back. I know sometimes it's rushed. I hope you're not offended by that. I'm just trying to get a laugh. So stay well, Casey, and thanks for calling. With that, let me call Nancy. Here comes a call to Nancy.
This is Nancy.
Nancy, Bob Saget. How are you?
Fine. How are you? Oh, I'm so excited.
Oh, I'm good now. All that energy makes me so happy. You've made my day. So how's it going? Where are you? I don't know this area code.
Oh, yeah. I'm in Tucson, Arizona, where it's like 104 degrees right now.
Now, is that good?
Actually, it isn't terrible. And we've just begun our kind of monsoon, you know, where it's starting to rain a little bit. So we've had 3 days of rain pretty much since January.
Well,
and it hasn't been heavy rain, but I'm really excited about getting rain. It's,
right.
It's like cleansing here.
It's better than dust devils, which you also
it's
right?
way better than dust and yeah. fires. That's what we had the first part of the pandemic summer.
It's like L.A. We were having them and sitting there waiting for. We have that app, Citizen, which tells you that, a man holding hammer down the block, you know. You know, man with stick, you know, but then it sometimes will say, you know, 1 mile away, major fire, get ready to evacuate. And then you
I know. And you have to read all of it.
It's crazy. Right? And then you look at all the comments from people and they're like, oh, this isn't happening. And then someone says, you don't know what you're talking about. I just called the fire department. It's here. And man with hammer doesn't exist. You know, it turns out. Go ahead. Sorry.
At least there's like an official imprimatur to that. Have you ever seen the stuff that's on, I think it's called Nextdoor? It's one of those community, I'm not even sure it's that one. It's one of those community sites that people can, and they're like, you know, man walking down the street at 10 a.m. wearing blue shirt doesn't belong here. Oh my God.
Well, that's unfortunately the tenor of the whole country right
Isn't
now
it?
As people
Isn't
go
it?
And say doesn't belong here, and that's like no yep. You don't belong here. Anybody with hate in their heart doesn't belong anywhere.
That's right.
How do you rehabilitate hate? That's how do you do that? Because back in the 60s it was, you know, the Beatles are going all you need is love, and you can't say that now. That's considered cynical, you know. Oh, don't give me that love crap. Look what's happened to all these people. And then you go, yeah, I understand the pain. So you got to get rid of hate. But you do need love and understanding. And I don't know.
Well, I know that intellectually, but I have a whole bunch of hate right now.
Yeah.
But I'm not purging very well, so it's really hard advice to give, right?
No, I know. I know. And you watch the news and you find yourself yelling at it and it's not healthy for you. And you're going, what? That's a lie. That's another lie. That's another lie. I just want to have, I just want to be on speakerphone with Tony Fauci. And, I don't know. We have some good people out there. We definitely do, but it would be wonderful to have some prophet type person that had all the answers that everyone listened to. And that would
like Ram Dass or something speaking to us, right?
I think people would stop in their tracks if Martin Luther King was to speak.
It's why I think John Lewis, I mean, watch it. I think that's why watching that the Kaysen cross the bridge, you know, with the driver across the Edmund Pettus Bridge with this man and, you know, his coffin covered with a flag. Did you watch that?
Yeah. Yeah.
It was so moving because it's kind of like, wow, you know, of the people, we can't afford to lose any more people who tell us the truth and who tell us what we should aspire to be.
I couldn't agree more.
We don't have those guys.
We all feel that way. And look what he persevered and look what how he sacrificed to be such a brilliant and wonderful man. And then you hear, I think the leader of your country should pay respects to that man and then refuses to.
Oh, yeah.
It should be a priority. That's how you put people together. That's how you get reelected, if that's all he cares about. That's how you do it. Unless he's counting on the people that would be angry at that aren't voting. But I think people are going to register, which they need to do. People need to register and vote. They need to register now.
Oh, absolutely.
So what's up? What's your life like?
Oh, so I was working at home in Tucson from basically like March 9th to, you know, now. And one Sunday night in May, I went to sleep, and when I woke up, I had apparently had a stroke.
Oh my God.
Yeah, an ischemic stroke, the brain damage kind, and it had knocked out my my hand, and I thought it was like carpal tunnel syndrome or something. I'm like, my hand didn't work, and I was hitting my, it was real spastic. I was hitting myself in the face with it. And I waited a couple of days because I thought, you know, oh, I'll see a orthopedist. And no, it was neurological, and I started having actually a second stroke and got myself to the hospital a few days later. And then I had to have carotid artery surgery, and then I had to go back into the hospital four other times. And it's just been a real interesting summer.
I'm so sorry you've been through that. Are you functioning you now? Know, are things,
yeah,
feelings coming I back? Had, did so, they do successful surgery?
They did. It was carotid artery surgery. I'm in that age group. And, you know.
Well, you sound about 32. I didn't know what was going on.
I'm almost 65. But I'm at the low end of that. And, I don't feel lucky to have had a stroke. On the other hand, I feel really lucky about the stroke I had and the relatively small amount of damage it did. Losing a hand isn't fun. But on the other hand, I think I can build it back up. And so I'm doing rehab with, you know, electrodes and pinto beans, transfer exercises and coloring books.
Well, let me go back to the pinto beans. You eat pinto beans or you raise a can in your hand? Or do they inject pinto beans?
Question. It's a good question.
Do they?
I should have drawn a better picture.
No, do they put pinto beans in a centrifuge and then inject it into your carotid arteries?
No, that would be the Donald Trump the cure.
Yeah, right. Let me inject pinto beans into my carotid arteries.
Right, exactly. Kind of a low point in your life. It's because is. With a pile of pinto beans and having your occupational therapist.
I'm sorry. Every time you say pinto beans, I want to laugh. No, I'm sorry. Please, I didn't mean
no,
to cut you off.
Funny.
Well, it is.
No, don't.
Go back to pinto beans. I'm sorry. I cut you off because I'm laughing at pinto beans. I'm picturing you working out with pinto beans, injecting them, eating them, rubbing them, shampooing with them. So what is the pinto bean?
Building an altar and praying to the gods with them. No.
A sandcastle, making a sandcastle out of pinto beans.
There you go. You do this dry. You do not cook the pinto beans first. That would be messy. You just have to learn to pinch them one by one and transfer them from one Tupperware container to the other. But let me tell you,
what do you do with the remains of the pinto beans? I mean, you're pinching them. You're pinching them as...
Oh, well, you're pinching them but not breaking them. Oh, no, they'll last forever. You can use those pinto beans for months on end because all you're doing is...
So when mankind is wiped out, it'll be cockroaches and pinto beans? That will be what's left?
Probably. That is probably right.
Wow. Yes. This pinto bean thing, I think you've got something here. So please continue about it. I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, that's all right. What do you think I've got?
I think you love pinto beans and they're saving your life. So you squashed them? Is that for therapy purposes?
No. The therapy is just the transfer of them, like having to pick up a little tiny bean because, of course, if your hand is shot, it's the pinching and precise fine motor movements that are the problem for you. So you need to do thousands of repetitions a day to really get your brain to do its job again with your fingers.
I
always forget that. I always forget that it's actually you're training your brain. You're not training your hand again. You're training your brain. But it's kind of also a low point because if you're like me and you're used to having a really active life and now you're marooned and you don't have any of your hobbies and you're sick and you've been in the hospital, to have to transfer pinto beans, like it's every nursing home nightmare, right? From one to the other, that's your major activity during a day. It almost killed me. I mean, it just drove me out of my mind. So I do other things other than the pinto beans.
Did they suggest knitting? I mean, is there anything else you could have done that maybe you would have had something to take home with you afterward?
Everything. Yeah, you put clothespins on. You put clothespins on things. Because clothespins are the pinching thing. I have this bionic thing called a music glove and you have a music game on the computer that you can play with it that makes you touch your fingers and make certain sounds.
Wow.
Coloring, adult coloring books. Nothing I would do if I wasn't drunk. You know, I would not do that.
Right. Drunk coloring is getting very popular again.
It's a pandemic, guys.
Right.
It's in the pandemic top 10, I think.
Do you think pinto beans could help cure COVID? Is there something?
I think they're magical.
Are these magic,
magic beans?
That's what I'm wondering. It sounds like they are. I mean, they've saved you. But it's kind of, I understand now, because people a lot of times would work out their hands when they have carpal tunnel with the clamps, and they would just squeeze the clamp all the time, like the giant clothespin. That's the idea. But you're starting because you were hit so hard, you had to start by literally trying to pick up a small bean. And that's seriously... quite amazing that you have to have such patience. Oh my God. It must be infuriating.
Can I tell you one thing that did happen in the hospital though?
Please.
When you have a stroke, but also during the pandemic, a lot of people are saying like, you have trouble remembering words because you're not in the same social situations and everything else. So I don't know if it was the stroke or the pandemic, but in the hospital, I kept mixing up the words euthanasia and anesthesia. Those are two really bad words.
Yeah, you don't want to get them mixed up when you're asking a doctor for, you know, could you do me a favor and give me some euthanasia?
That really was. So I did that so often in a conversation with the anesthesiologist that they made me take the now famous cognitive test.
Oh my God. So you know, it's very difficult.
I aced it.
Right.
It's very difficult. They couldn't believe that I could do it.
You have the best words. You're a genius. I can't believe it.
I am. I'm just a genius. Oh. Nobody in Tucson has ever done it the way I did.
Nobody has. You have the best ever.
Nobody.
Well, it's also important that you stay healthy. And I just want to say, I want to say a few words about pinto beans. I'm a big fan. This, I'm Bob Saget, and I support this message about pinto beans and their usefulness and how they've gotten you through a hard time. It's something as simple as a pinto bean. I had some difficult times because I had a lot of people around me, and then I ate baked beans, and then I found out I had less people around me. The more...
You know, it's funny how they just go away, huh?
They leave you. It's like a fog of alienation. It just... I've scared them off. Well, I wish you continued health and recovery. And thank you for calling me. You're really...
Oh, it's been such a treat to talk to you. Oh. It has been so great. Thank you.
Thank you. You're so sweet. Be well and go easy.
I will.
Go easy on yourself. And pinto beans rule. That's all I got.
It'll be our code. You can always just mention that in a moment of distress on your podcast. You can say pinto beans and I'll call again.
I'm going to talk about them a lot. So keep your ears peeled and your pinto beans peeled. Keep peeling.
There you go. There you go.
Pinching and peeling. Get that outer casing off.
Take care, Bob Saget. Thank you.
Thanks so much. Be well. Thank you, Nancy.
Bye.
Bye-bye. I'm going to try Casey one more time because Casey called and I left a message and told him to wipe front to back and then we'll be at the end of this episode. But I'll leave him another message because I like to be obnoxious because I always find that funny.
Hello?
Yo, Casey, Bob Saget. How you doing?
Oh, my God. Dude, I am sorry I missed you.
Yeah, but I left you an important message and told you you need to wipe front to back. Did I hit a nerve there? Have you been making any mistakes in that area?
Well, you know, sometimes I like to switch it up because, you know, you need some dexterity.
No. That's just double talk. You can't wipe back to front because you'll end up with a rash. It burns through. That's poo. You can't do it. I'm just telling you, son. Trust me.
Well, I do appreciate that. Those are words of wisdom.
Do you have a garden hose? You could go out in the yard and maybe clean it out.
I do, actually. And you know what? That has saved us quite a bit on toilet paper.
Yeah. So I would say when we're done talking, I want you to go outside and just get that garden hose and work it up in there and do it in the front yard so the neighbors can see and maybe they'll fear you. They'll stay away.
You know, that's a good point. When this virus is done, I won't have to worry about anyone knocking on my door.
No, you should do it now so no one comes by. I mean, I wouldn't I don't deliver mail to someone if they've got a garden hose up their butt, you know?
That's an excellent point.
So where are you? What part of this country are you in?
I'm in Monrovia, California.
And how's it going there? Are we having COVID issues where you are?
It's not quite as bad.
Right.
And luckily, me and, you know, my immediate family, we have been unaffected because, you know, we've been staying home, wearing the mask, just, you know, doing what you're supposed to do.
But don't you know it's your right as an American to not wear the mask? I don't understand that. Yeah,
people are fucking stupid. I'm sorry. Am I allowed to curse?
Oh, fuck yeah. But the thing is, I mean, okay. If someone has like syphilis all over their face, I would say, you know, hey, it's my human right to kiss you with my syphilitic face. I guess
that's what makes us American, right?
Well, the thing is, it's invisible and people don't believe it exists and don't think it'll hurt them.
Oh, man.
And then once in a while you hear about somebody that got it and then they say, I do believe in it. And then especially well-known people or politicians that were against it. And then all of a sudden they're cool with it, with wearing the mask. It's ludicrous that people don't listen to smart people.
I know. And it's like, I tend to, you know, I want to listen to all the scientists and doctors around the world. I think they're much smarter than I am and probably most of us. I'm thinking, like, there's got to be, like, a test to be president. Like, I know he did that.
He took it. He took the test and he aced it.
Oh, great. He knows what an elephant is. Good. Now I feel good.
Listen, it was the best ever reporting of the results of the best ever taken cognitive test. Horse, dog, poop, nuts. It should have been all dirty words. It should have been just parts of the body, you know?
Oh, that would have been good.
Wiener, nipples, you know, toenails, grandma, you know? So what can I help you with? What, do you have a question for me? Do you have a job you're able to do right now? Are you working?
Well, actually, I work at a high school, and I work one-on-one with special needs students.
Oh,
however,
you're a good man.
Obviously right now, huh?
You're a good man.
Oh, thank you. Not everyone would say that.
Well, the special needs people that you help say it, I'm sure.
And I love that. It's incredibly rewarding. But yeah, right now we're on summer break, so we haven't started back up. So, you know, right now I'm kind of just hanging out at home, taking care of my kid and my wife. I was actually changing a poopy diaper when you called before. Not my kids. It was my own.
So when I'm psychic. So when I said wipe front to back and you were changing a diaper at that moment. So I am certifiably psychic.
You're right. That proves it.
Is it a boy or girl that you were cleaning?
He's a boy. His name is Lincoln.
And Lincoln, and was it a solid? Was it a Lincoln log that he made, or was it more of the baby liquid form?
It was solid. It was little nuggets. I think he's a little plugged up right now.
Do you give him dog food, or are you giving him regular stuff?
Oh, we give him dog food because that's all we can afford right now.
Sorry to hear that. Dog food's expensive.
No, we got like prunes and raisins and shit. I'm trying to load him up with that so he can.
Well, don't do that. He'll have projectile diarrhea. Don't do that. He'll spin around. He'll have a little exorcist baby. Don't do that. Give him like applesauce.
I was hoping it would spray the walls like, you know, spider paint.
Right. So then you could redecorate at the same time.
Exactly.
Yeah. It'd be like trading spaces. So congrats on the baby, by the way.
Thank you.
Is it your first child?
He is, actually. My wife, we actually have another one on the way. She is at 3 months now.
Wow, that's exciting. So that's what quarantine will do. Quarantine will give you children, or it'll give you a divorce.
Pretty much. Or give you death.
It can do that. Did you have a question for me? Is there something you wanted to talk about?
Well, aside from, you know, I just wanted to wonder how you and your family are doing. I hope you guys are all well.
Look at you, what a good person you are. I'm good. Well, I'm good.
Good.
My kids are far away. I have a couple kids in New York and a daughter out here. So I miss them all quite a bit. I've been able to see one of my daughters. She's at her mom's.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, but it's difficult. And then I talk to people. One of the nice things about this podcast is I get to talk to people and find out there's like 10 people in the house and a family that would have never seen each other or had any time to talk to each other. So it's a weird thing that I think we'll look back on and hoping that people are well will find comfort in the time that they regrounded the ones that did. Yeah. So Lincoln, what are your hopes for Lincoln in this crazy world that we have ahead?
I just want him to be a good, loving person, just to grow up without, because you see too many people who are ignorant and you have the racism and just all this bullshit. It's like, I just want to raise a kid who is down to earth and not a piece of shit. That's all I can hope.
Well, that's beautiful because racism is a taught thing. And, you learn it from people that are they're not right. You know, they're just, they have hatred about people that are different and they want to keep people down and they're just wrong. They're just humanly incorrect. Yeah. And I think you can really help him by stop getting poop on his nuts. I think that would really help. Because it sounds to me like when I called, you were literally wiping back to front. And tell me that that's the truth. You screwed up. Tell me.
No, you're right. I did. And he had little crumbles in his sack, and it's not good.
Let me tell you something, and you listen carefully, because I'm a father, and I have all daughters. Uh-huh. But the truth is, if he gets shit on his nuts, you can ruin him for life. You want him to love other people? He's going to have burning nuts that itch him the rest of his life. Because there are scars, not unlike COVID. If you get poop on your sack, it can eat away. And I swear to you, he'll be scratching his balls his whole life and have sense memory that his father rubbed his own excrement on his testicles. And that's medical talk. And I know what I'm talking about because my mother did it to me. And my balls itch about 12 hours a day. I scratch them all the time because I think it's good luck.
You know, the best part of this is that I get to, you know, relay all this information to him someday and tell him that it was from good old Bob Saget.
Yeah, you'll hear it right here on the podcast. It's not going anywhere, so this will be on that episode. Oh, and when he's older, you'll be able to download it. You know how to do that. And and you'll have it. Have it for posterior, because that's where you're rubbing the poop from, right out of his little butt crack, right onto his nutsack. So stop it. Stop it. I'm telling you, it's just as one man to another. Please, Casey, you know?
You know what, Bob? I will do it right from now on.
Front to back. That way it goes up the back crack, and you don't really, at the top of your butt crack, itch. It doesn't itch. You don't get a rash there.
I do not want him to be itching and hurting, you know? That's the last thing. But we have this stuff that's literally called butt paste. And it's really good, gushy stuff. It comes on the taint and the balls.
I brush my teeth with it.
I use it myself.
I brush my teeth with it, and that's why I have a shit-eating grin. That would be the dad joke there.
God.
Look, come on. That's how I was raised. What can I tell you? My mother wiped crap on my nuts, and my dad taught me dumbass jokes. That's how I was reared.
No, I love that. That's all me and my friends do.
Yeah, it's just nonsense to get us through this crazy world we live in. So
exactly.
Well, you're a good man. Is there anything else you want to chat about?
Well, I mean, the one topic I wanted to bring up, I wasn't sure if anyone else would talk about it, is, you know, just like UFOs, aliens.
They're among us.
I've seen a lot. Oh, yeah. Like, I haven't seen so many more just like, you know, officials and people who had worked, you know, in.
Yeah, Joe Rogan's been talking about it. Joe Rogan did a whole thing about it, and I started to research it myself, and I've always felt there might be government things up there that obviously they would deny, that there's new kind of weird stealth things and cloaking devices might actually exist. So they could be coming from us. If they're coming from another planet, please, you know, get rid of all the bad people. No, I can't wish that. I can't wish that. It's not Independence Day. We don't want that because... The aliens and Independence Day are among us anyway.
Yeah, they were bad. I just read something recently where a scientist who used to work at Area 51, he had alien pictures, and he claimed that there are already two different types of aliens that work for us in the government, and that we have, you know, their spacecrafts and blah, 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 and, you know, they've added to our technology, and it's like, I don't know. I mean, it sounds kind of nuts, but it's like, I don't know, who's to say he's wrong? Like,
well,
it's not that crazy to
believe. I think there's so many conspiracy theories that are contradicting conspiracy theories. I think we can only deal with fact, and we don't know what fact is, but we do know.
Yeah.
All we know right now is that we've got to change. The world has to change, yeah. And we got to get this disease cured. And meaning at bay, because people still die from the flu. More people, I hate those statistics. Well, more people die from the flu, so why do we care about COVID? It's like, because there's a vaccine for the flu, and we need one for COVID. So it's not.
Yeah, and the flu never shut down the world. So it's kind of different.
Well, I think it did. I think when it first happened, people were dying everywhere, but they were going about their business, but they were dying. And then many people didn't. So some people are going, hey, COVID's not going to kill everybody. Let's just go back to work as normal. Get in the pool, everybody. So I am open to anything that I can understand and it's real. And if a thing happens like Cloverfield or Independence Day or Mars Attack or any of that crap we've been watching all of our lives. We've been watching the past 20 years, all it is end of the world movies. I mean, from War of the Worlds, that's the original, to Planet of the Apes, the original, it's really about what mankind does to self-destruct. And we are on a path of a trajectory at the moment of narcissism and egocentricity and just complete there's no compassion for other people. And once we can somehow move the needle to 51% of the people care about other people, which I'd like to believe. I think we'll be on a better road. But I'm open to conspiracy theories. I'm open to, UFOs. I mean, I definitely think there's life outside of here. There better be, because a lot of life here is messed up.
I've never seen one myself, but I mean, I've seen enough videos where it's like the same image from multiple cameras and sources, and it's just weird stuff. I'm like, well, like, there's something out there.
Well, I had an ex-girlfriend, and I'm positive she was from another planet, and it might have been Mercury, because she was hot, but she's gone now. I gotta go because it's the end of my show, but I can't thank you enough for answering, and I can't believe see, that's where I believe in other things, that there are things going on that I knew that you were doing something of wiping back to front, and it turned out it was Lincoln's butt to his nuts. And so will you work on that, Casey?
I will. And, you know, you knew that my life was revolving around poo right now.
Yeah, absolutely. I've had three daughters. It was everywhere. The world is one giant fudgicle.
That's right.
The world's completely full of shit right now, and you were just dealing with it, which is why I'm glad I called you back.
Yeah, thank you so much for calling me back, sir.
Well, you be well, and say hi to your wife, and tell her that you're what I told you, that you've been doing it wrong, and make sure she's doing it right. I'm sure she is. It's you're the one that's messing it up because you're rushing.
Oh, she's definitely doing it right.
Of course. She's a mother. You're just some guy that doesn't care if you get your kid's shit all over the place, but you got to. And start feeding him solid food. Although he's got Lincoln Log, you said he's constipated. So don't give a baby prunes, please. Please don't do it. Here's your prune juice. Now go to bed.
Yeah, okay.
Because when he's 50 and he shits the bed, he's going to blame you.
He's going to think back to this moment.
Absolutely. And he's scratching his nuts because you burned him with poop. So stop it.
I'm going to have that written on my tombstone.
No, don't do that. Just write it on the wall with a Sharpie and know that it came from me. That's what I imparted from me to you today.
Okay, thank you.
You be well, and all safety and health to you and your family, man. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. You too.
Thanks, Casey. Have a good one.
All right, take care.
Bye-bye. Sometimes there's a cosmic connection, so there you go. I wish you all safety and health, you know. What am I, a rabbi? Hope not. Everybody's gone through all this anti-Semitic stuff. Hey, stop that, would you? It's really annoying, and it's wrong. And racism. Hey, can you work on that? Sending you all a lot of love and good wishes. And you know what you got to do? You subscribe, you follow, you rate, review this podcast. And I'll be talking to you guys. I love calling people and talking to them. And I get a lot from it. So thank you very, very much. And wishing you all a lot of good health. Bye-bye.
Would you be surprised if scientists are learning how to fight COVID-19 from World of Warcraft?
As soon as you see that bolt go out, as soon as the person gets diseased, they have to run away from the group really fast.
What if I told you that I could spoil almost any movie based on who uses an iPhone?
The first guideline is that the user is a good guy. It says that just very specifically.
Or that the cute Animal Crossing virtual world has turned into a capitalist nightmare that people are spending tons of real money on.
Like, I took literally all the money I had, put it in the stock market, and then went on Twitter and, like, typed in turnips and then refreshed over and over again until I found a good island price that I could do it.
Did you know that Disney apparently has a preoccupation with butts?
I'm fine with butts. Pretty pro-butt in general.
I'm really struggling to develop a strong opinion about butts for you, and I don't have one.
Well, that's Wild Wild Tech, the podcast that brings you the wildest, most bizarre, the most interesting stories about tech and how it's shaping our culture. Wild Wild Tech is hosted by Jordan Erica Weber, that's me.
And me, Joshua Rivera.
And every week, we'll uncover infamous stories in pop culture and tech, and we'll learn from the experts and talk to the people who lived through these weird stories.
Like when the two computer programmers decided to create an AI that made billions of melodies just to disrupt the world of copyright law.
Or when they made Steph Curry so good in NBA 2K, it broke the game.
Or the time when...
You know what? You should just listen. Subscribe to Wild Wild Tech for free on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts.